And I remember I was watching on television one time. I think it was one of the opera reunions that Goldie Hill was on there talking about your dad, and they played an old clip from him from the 60s. And she said that he actually sold more records than Hank Williams, which I was not aware of. And I don't think many people are aware of that. I don't know.
He totally did. He had, I think he had 70-something top five hits. That is a lot of hits.
And even in the years when he was not making a lot of hits towards into the later 70s, he still had at least one record on the charts for every year he recorded, which is still pretty impressive, too. Very impressive.
He's a dynamic performer, and that's, I mean, he's got it, you know. He just always has had it, and I mean, we walk into Cracker Barrel, and he's, you know, they don't even like ask him where he wants to sit. He goes straight to his table, and they bring him his coffee.
I'm gonna ask you, how much has your dad been an influence on your career in music?
He's been an influence. I won't say musically as much that as his wisdom about the business. His wisdom about don't do it if you're not happy, if you're getting too tired and you burn out, don't do it. Stop.
That's essentially, you know, what he did in a way when he was done doing what he wanted to do. He stopped more or less.
And also too, you know, about not getting you know, too full of yourself, and definitely don't put up with any crap. You know, remain true to yourself, and that's how he did it. And it served him well, and he's always said, you know, he said the business afforded me the life that I always dreamed of, which was to be a cowboy and have my horse ranch and family, and that's what it did. You know, he loves music. I mean, he loves all the old stuff. He loves all the Bob Wills stuff and
just like
Western Swing, and he plays me stuff now and then. He likes this. He loves Asleep at the Wheel. And who I'm going to get on his CD, whether they like it or not. I'm calling Ray Benson up and just make him do it.
They're fabulous, and I have just about every album of your dad, starting with the very first one. I think it was the first LP my grandfather ever purchased. Smith's the name. Way back, and I have just about every one. It's fun to see how over the years, especially towards the end, a lot of his music was very influenced was full of swing influences. In the end,
he loves it. That's his favorite. And also too, it's like he loves bluegrass music. He like he loves the soundtrack to Oh Brother, Where Art Thou. He listens to music actually. You know, pretty often when he's in his car. His friends, he gives him CDs that they think he'll like, and he'll listen to them. And he likes my CD, and it's the first time I think he's ever told me that he really thinks my CD's really good.
And that's your new CD, Stronger, correct?
My new CD, yeah. And he thinks John McPhee, my producer, is a genius. He said he played everything on there, and I was like, yeah. And he said, oh my gosh, he said he's genius.
That is impressive.
And I've never had that much. Sometimes. You know, I mean, he's always told me he's proud of me and stuff, and he's always thought certain things were good, but he's never told me he thought something was great until this record. And for that, I'm so thankful, because I want him to be proud of me and know that I'm carrying on the kind of way that I can. In fact, the song, Break My Little Heart in Two, I tried to kind of write it in a voice that was Carl Smith-esque, you know, like
fabulous song.
In a kind of style of Carl Smith record. And that was, you know, like that kind of honky-tonk kind of stuff.
Sure. He was king of the honky-tonks. So.
Yeah. And no, I love my daddy to bits. He's, you know, every little girl loves her daddy, but he's particularly special. And
you got to get him to record a full album.
I don't know if that's going to happen, sweetie. He's comfortable.
Oh, I bet. Does he still show horses?
Well, you know, he retired from that when he was 79. I think he was 79, something like that. Well, let's see, no, he was 76 when he stopped showing horses. But he still gets a lot of calls of people wanting his advice on training and stuff. And he still goes to a lot of the horse shows and has all of his quarter horse buddies and cutting horse buddies. And He still has his last horse that he worked with, but he just, it's just too much for him to have a whole bunch of horses anymore. And he has,
yeah,
he still has his farm, and he still mows the whole place himself and takes care of his horse and rides his horse every day, you know, weather permitting. And I think that's really why he's still kicking, you know.
Yeah, and there's also a kind of switch a little bit, a song on your album Stronger that you wrote for your stepfather Johnny Cash.
Yeah.
It takes one to know me. And could you please tell us how Johnny Cash has influenced your music or your career?
Well, gosh, where do I start with that? Because he was one of the first people to teach me other people's songs. He taught me Bob Dylan songs. He taught me Eric Anderson songs. He taught me a lot about performing by watching him every night. Can I say that?
Oh, I don't know. We'll hopefully.
You do something when you go. Well, they might think I'm saying something else. But anyway, he just taught me a lot about respecting the audience and being present to the audience. We were great, great close. He was really a daddy to me. We were greatly close, and I've always say that I've had the best possible family in the whole world, because I've had two beautiful mothers, you know, Goldie Hill and my mother, and I've had two beautiful fathers, my father and Johnny Cash, and they've all given me so much life knowledge and I don't know, like values about things, and don't take anything for granted. You know, I think a lot of artists sometimes, you know, they get up there and start doing good and they start taking it for granted and they lose sight of what it's about. And what it's really about is sharing your experience with other people that have similar experiences and giving them a moment of like relief from whatever might be going on in their life, you know. You're making them laugh, make them cry, make them want to dance, make them want to, you know,
yeah,
run out of the building.
Carlene Carter has left the building. I guess your tour next year is going to feature a tribute to your grandmother, Maybelle, who it'll be her, I guess, 100th anniversary of her birthday.
Uh-huh.
Coming
yeah.
up.
Yeah, we're gonna put together something for that, and you know, to honor the Carter family and Grandma's contribution to country music and to folk music and to all music, actually. You know, her guitar style, her auto harp playing, all the great songs that her and AP and Sarah had together. But for it to be about women, you know, I mean, the things, I come from a long line of women that make music, and I think that that's been the biggest influence on me, is the women that I grew up with and their attitude. And there was never an audience too small or too big. And it was always, you know, they always did their absolute best, and they never complained about anything. They just got it. They lived to do it, you know. And I always joke around, and maybe I've told you this before, I don't know if we've talked before or not, but I always joke around and say, I know exactly what I'm doing when I hit the stage. I know exactly what I'm doing when I'm writing a song. Rest of my life, I'm not quite sure about.
Oh, it's, well, I'd like to thank you so much, Carlene, for taking your time and coming on the show. We always enjoy your music here, the music of your family. You're a true legend, a country music royalty.
Well, thank you so much, honey. I appreciate that.